Welcome to Behold the Real Jesus broadcast, brought to you by the Jesus Only Broadcasting Network, located at www.jobn.tv, where you can go and see and hear the preaching of the Apostles' Doctrine of Christ, the Jesus Only Doctrine. Neighbor, if you've been tuning in, we've been talking about the two witnesses of Revelation 11, and it is very imperative that we prepare ourselves for the coming of the Lord, that there is a work of the ministry that lies ahead for the body of Christ before the day of the Lord. Before the day of the Lord, there will be a great work. There will be a time, times and a half, 3.5 years, 42 months of power given to my two witnesses. That is not after the rapture and somebody setting up in heaven, getting fat for 7 years and then coming back. It is the work of the ministry going through tribulation, the work of patience, patience work of experience, experience work of hope. Hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost. Think it not strange the fiery trials which is to try us, as though some strange thing happened to us, but rejoice in as much as we are partakers of Christ's sufferings. And the glory of God resteth upon our forehead. Rest upon our heads, how? Because the glory is got through the sufferings. 1 Peter 4:1, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. What was that? 1 Peter 4:1 says, for as much then Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, be ye therefore likewise minded. For he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. If we don't suffer with him, we will not reign with him. Paul said, troubled on every side, but not in distress, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but not destroyed, always bearing about in our body the dying of the Lord Jesus. For we which live are always delivered unto death, that the life of our Lord Jesus may be made manifest in our mortal bodies. And this light affliction, which is only but for a moment, worketh for us a more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Jesus said that they may see my glory. And that is the two witnesses there, that power given to my two servants that have glory. And we're going to be talking about this glory that's revealed in and through the church. Here's the two cherubim of glory. They're of the mercy seat. In the mercy seat, look toward the mercy seat, Church of the Living God, one with Jesus. And that is in the holiest of all, the most holy place. Here we have the cherubim there that are outside and overshadow this mercy seat. The mercy seat is right here, but now we have two colossal olive trees overlaid with gold cherubims with their wings stretched, one touching one wall of the most holy place, and the other one touching the other wall of the most holy place. Each of these cherubim are 10 cubits high with a wingspan of 5 on each wingspan that goes all the way on the 20 cubits on the walls of the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. This is what we're talking about in the two witnesses. Let's take a good look at who these are. The cherubim of glory, I want to carry you to 1 Kings. Now we know in Revelation 11, matter of fact, let's take a look at Revelation 11 here. Let's take a look here, and there was given to me a reed likened to a rod. That rod is to measure the temple of God, the altar, and them that worship therein. But the court which was at the temple, leave out, measure not, is given unto the Gentiles, because the rod of God is not upon the head of the wicked. And the holy city shall be trodden underfoot 42 months. Now, 42 months is a time, times and a half, is a 3.5 years, is 1,203 score days. Why is that important? because in the work of the ministry of the two witnesses that we're going to have Jesus beginning his ministry about the age of 30, fulfilling his own law there. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, and he's coming under his own law. In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made in under the law. He's going to keep the law and go back to his former glory. Well, Jesus' ministry started at age 30, and he went 3 1/2 years. It started in tabernacles. It's going to end in tabernacles. Listen here, 3 1/2 years, 42 months, times and a half, and 1,203 score days. And Jesus, it says in Daniel 9, there he will confirm the covenant of many for 1 week. That week is a heptad, or a week of years, or 7 years. But Jesus was cut off in the midst of the week. And that in the midst of the week, but not for himself. And who shall declare his generation? By body of Christ, that will be you, the servants of the living God. For they are the ones that will have this 3 1/2 year work of the ministry, 42 months, times and dividing of a time, or 1,203 score days of the Jesus ministry. This is the work of the ministry. There, the gospel of Jesus Christ being preached in all the world for witness in all nations, then the end will come. Well, as we see here, this is exactly what's happening in Revelation 11. God is given power to his two witnesses. Somebody say, well, that's Moses and Elijah. That's Moses and Enoch and a different controversy with these two prophets. Let's take a look at who that is. Jesus, and we're going to see over here, and let me see if I can find that right quick. John 8, take a look here. Jesus, everything is Jesus. The whole volume of the book is written to me. I come to do thy will, O God. Search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they that testify of me. Everything in the word of God refers to Jesus. Now take a look here, John 8:13. The Jesus came there. The Pharisees, who was always trying to trip Jesus up, said, Jesus, you bear record of yourself. You're just one man. You can't do that. Your record is not true, because everything is in the mouth of two witnesses. Jesus answered and said, though I bear record of myself, my record is true. For I know whence I came and whither I go, but you cannot tell whence I come and whither I go. Well, where'd he go? He came from God. He's the Son of Man that came to the world, which is the Word, which is the light, which is the life, which is the light of man. He is that Son of Man. No man's ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, the Son of Man, which is in heaven. And this is why we're going to see the designation of Son of Man in Ezekiel, talking about the cherubim of glory, because it includes the body of Christ, being bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh, which are the two cherubim of glory that we're going to see here and the two witnesses. He said, you judge after the flesh, I judge no man. And if I judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but I am the Father that sent me. Now, that looks like 1 + 1 = 2. Not so. Because 1 is the man Christ Jesus, and the Father is the Spirit that he is without measure. For 1 + 1 = 1 there. For it is also written in your law that the testimony, that's the testimony of Jesus, that's the spirit of prophecy that you find in Revelation 19:10. There was a man that John came upon in Revelation 19:10, and he was going to worship him. And that man said, ooh, see that thou doest not. I'm of thy fellow brethren and of thy servants that have the testimony of Jesus. This is that testimony. I have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. That is the church of the living God in its highest glory. Jesus said, I'm one that bear witness of myself. Well, let's take a look at that. Jesus is right here. He's standing there before them. They said, Jesus, you're this man. There's only one standing there, and you bear record of yourself, so your record's not true, because you've got to have someone else to bear record of you. Jesus said, though I bear record of myself, my witness of myself, my record is true, because I'm not alone. I'm one that bear witness of myself. There's one, the man Christ Jesus. And then he also says, and then he said, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me. Sent me, yes. He is the Word that came into the world was made flesh. The Word is the same Spirit as the Father. It's the same Spirit as the Holy Ghost. It's the same Spirit of Jehovah. There's only one Spirit of God, different offices, but the self-same Spirit. And the Word, and begins the Word with God, the Word was God, the same as in the beginning with God, all things were made by Him. There's the Him. And without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, the life was the light of man. And this true light left from every man that cometh to the world. Now take a look here. Jesus said, I'm one that bear record of myself and my Father. Well, Father is a spirit. Father is a spirit there. The Spirit of God, they think, is up here somewhere in heaven. They don't know that all the fullness of that Godhead is in that man Christ Jesus right there. And that's what Jesus is telling them. There is two witnesses there. Notice what he says. I'm one that bear witness to myself. I am this man and my Father there that sent me. He beareth witness of me. Now take a look. Let's carry this on about the two witnesses. Jesus has already set the precedent. They said to him, where is your Father? They said they did not understand that Jesus is this Father of glory. They think he's up there somewhere. They don't understand that the Father dwelling in him, the Spirit of God dwelling in him, the Father's one doing all the works. The Father's one healing the sick, cleansing the leper, raising the dead, casting out devils, opening blind eyes, loose the dumb tongue, the lame walking, captive going free. Well, Jesus, they said, where is your Father? Jesus said, if you had known me, you should have known my Father also. Now, what's he saying here? These words spake Jesus in the treasury as he taught in the temple. No man laid hands on him because his hour was not yet come. Everything has a season and a time. Then Jesus said again unto them, I go my way, because he's the way, the truth, the life. Came from God, going back to God. You shall seek me and shall die in your sins. Whew, that's pretty strong. Whither I go, you cannot come. Well, where's he going? He's going back to the glory of the Father, glorified with the Father's own self. John 17:5. Then said the Jews, will he kill himself? Because he saith, whither I go, you cannot come. Jesus said unto them, you are from beneath. I'm from above. What's he saying there? You're from beneath. You are earthly men. I am that man that came down from heaven. There's your John 3:13. No man sent up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. There, Jesus saying, I am the Father. You're from beneath. I am from above. I am the Father of glory. Then he goes on and says, you are of this world. I am not of this world. He's claiming he is the Father. I said, therefore unto you, now catch this, that you shall die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am, he is written in italics, that I am, the I am, you shall die in your sins. What he's saying there, neighbor, that we have followed cunningly devised fables, denying the only Lord God. He's only one. Why? Because he is this Father of glory. He said, it's written in your law. It's written in your law, the testimony of two men is true. I am one that beareth witness of myself, and my Father that sent me, he beareth witness of me. There's your two witnesses right there. Jesus has already said, the body of Christ is one witness, and we are now, while he's in the world, he's the light of the world. Now, he said, speed, I go away, for I go not away, the comfort of the Holy Ghost will not come. He said, I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. Well, the body of the Christ now is literally the Holy Ghost, Jesus Christ, Christ in you, the hope of glory. He's the head, we are the body, that makes one. That is your two witnesses. I'm one to bear witness to myself, my Father's Spirit. He's the other one that beareth witness of me. And that's the reason God gives power unto those two witnesses. When you see that it's written in your law, the testimony of two men is true. That is the testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy. I'm one that beareth witness of myself. There's one witness. And the other one, the Father that sent me. That's your other witness. There's your two witnesses right there. It's not going to change. You may have two men walking around down here, and they're only two witnesses. They are going to cover the whole earth. Well, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world for witness in all nations, and the end shall come. Who will do that? the body of Christ will. Well, let's take a look here. He is that Father of glory. He was manifest in that flesh, and that is the whole mystery of godliness. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God himself was manifest in the flesh. Now, see, let's see this. Many people think that Father's one person up there, and this Son of God, he's another person, second person of Godhead, and somewhere up there somehow, the Holy Ghost is somewhere else. Anyhow, this is the Father of glory manifest in a body of flesh. That is one, neighbor. That is two. That's not three. We followed cunningly devised fables denying the only Lord God. So God is moving now with the confirmation of that word in the testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy, to those that will hear. And though any man have an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. What is that? That Jesus is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning, the end, which is, was, and is to come, the Almighty God. He is a blessed and only potentate, 1 Timothy 6:15. So therefore, Jesus, when they did not understand that, they said again, that if you don't believe it, I am he, who, the Father, you will die in your sin. They ask again, who are you? Jesus said to them, even the same that I said unto you from the beginning. What was from the beginning? The Word. God's from the beginning, always has been and will be God. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. I've said that to you from the beginning. What's the said? The said is the Word of God. And he said, I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true. That Spirit is manifest in a body of flesh. He and me is one and the self same person, friend. He is the image of the invisible God, the express image of his singular person. He is the brightness of his glory. He said, I speak to the world those things which I've heard of him. They understood not, and they still do not understand that he speaks to them of the Father. Oh, listen, neighbor, we have to get a hold of this. God's going to have a great work. It's going to be manifest in and through the bride of Christ. Now, where are we going? Revelation 7 says that we're going to be sealed. In Ezekiel 9, we got talking there the other day in this broadcast that there was going to be a sealing going on there. Let me see if I can find that. Ezekiel, the 9th chapter, there we go. And he cried in my ears and said, cause them to have charge over the city, come near, every man with a destroying weapon in his hand. That is that city, the city of the living God. Six men came from the way of the higher gate. That higher gate is toward the north. Jesus abides in the sides of the north. Every man with a slaughter weapon in his hand. This is judgment. One man among them clothed with linen, the righteousness of the saints, with a writer's ink horn by his side. They went in and stood beside the brazen altar because that's judgment, the altar of burnt offering. The glory of God of Israel has gone up from the cherubim to the threshold of the house. He called to the man clothed with linen, which is the righteousness of the saints, which had the writer's ink horn by his side. Take a look at this. He said, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, set a mark. That mark is not on a law. If you look it up, that mark is a tav. It's the last letter of the Hebrew abecedary. A's the first. In English, it's the Z. It's he that overcometh to the end. Set a mark upon the foreheads of the man of Sai and cry for all the abominations done in the midst thereof. And when he did that, he said, go ye after him through the city, smite, let not your eyes spare. Why do we have to have that sealing? Why do we have to have that sealing of the living God? And that is because in Revelation 7, verse 1, God's going to seal his body, his church, with that seal. It is the engraving of a signet. That signet is the ruble. The signet is a sign. Jesus is given to the sign to the people. The signet is a sign, a lav tav. That's the first and last letter of the Hebrew ABC to you, because Jesus is all that God is from A to Z. That is a signature of God, the signet, and that is the engraving of a signet. The first one was upon the shoulders of the high priest in Exodus 28, according to birth. Well, you came into the kingdom of God. You repented and was baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. You received the gift of the Holy Ghost. And that is your birth. Yeah, your birth then. Then there was a work of God. You presented your body, living sacrifice, all acceptable unto God, which was your reasonable service. You were not conformed to this world. You were transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is a good and acceptable and perfect will of God for you is. Well, there you have it. You're doing the will of God now. That's a breast. That is the second engraving of a signet in the breastplate of judgment, doing the will of God. But the last one, the last little engraving of that signet will be that third. It's in the third day. And in that engraving of a signet will be up on the high priest's mitre. It's a crown. It is the mitre. Which is the crown of the priesthood, which priesthood we're called as kings and priests of the Lord our God. And that's what's happening here in Revelation 7. He said, after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth. They're holding the four winds of the earth back, that it should not blow on the earth, nor the sea, nor any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east. The east is RMD. That's 144 gematria, having the seal. The seal is a signet. The signet is that signet of the sign of the Loftah. It's a measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. It's a seal of the living God. He cried with a loud voice. This voice is a voice of many waters, the voice of the Almighty, to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea. He said, you don't hurt the earth, sea, trees, until we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. What is happening there in Ezekiel 9? Seal, set a mark upon those that are crying out, for the sins and abominations done in the city. Well, that's what we do. We have a burden for the lost. We're crying out for the lost to be saved. Seal the servants of our God in their foreheads, not on it, in it. And these are the ones, 144,000, the RMD. And that RMD is 100, the R, 100, M, 40, D, 4. And then 1,000 is perfected glory. It's a church of the living God, come with the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, because they are the ones that God is going to use in this last days. When you see here in Revelation 12, we find the same instead of two witnesses there. Let's go back to those two witnesses there. When we see the two witnesses that we are taking a look at there in 1 Kings, we're going to see that they're the olive trees, two olive trees, and they're the two candlesticks. Well, what are those? We see here in 1 Kings that we're going to have the oracle, that is the holiest of all, made of two cherubims of olive tree. There's your two witnesses. There's two. Of an olive tree, each 10 cubits high. That's this one here. There's your Ark of the Covenant down here. Yeah, it's your mercy seat there. But these are overshadowing the mercy seat. Why? Because it's the work of God in the last days to all nations. To if any man have an ear to hear, let him hear. That is these two colossal one. And there's the other two witnesses right there in that overshadowing this mercy seat right here. It is the two colossal cherubim of glory. And you see there of an olive tree. Revelation 11, these are the two olive trees, the two candlesticks. They're 10 cubits high. This is not the same cherubim that are in the mercy seat of the mercy seat and look toward the mercy seat. This is the work of God on the last days through the church of the living God. You'll find that 5 cubits was one ring of the cherubim, 5 cubits the other wing of the cherubim. That is overshadowing the mercy seat, and the other part to the uttermost part of the other were 10 cubits. The other cherub was 10 cubits high. Both of the cherubims were of one measure. What's that one measure? That measure that comes even unto us, which is Jesus Christ. We're one with him. One measure, one Lord, one faith, one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one God, Father of all, above all, through all, and in us all. The height of the one cherub was 10 cubits. So was it of the other cherub. There's your two witnesses. The cherubim within the house, they stretched for the wings of the cherub. So the wing of one touched the one wall, and the wing of the other cherub touched the other wall. These are the walls of salvation to the fullest of measure of the stature of Jesus Christ. And their wings touched one another, making everything one. He overlaid the cherubim with gold. What's gold? It's the glory of God. It is that luster of the glory of God, and carved all the walls of the house round about with carved figures of cherubim and palm trees. This is all tabernacles. We see that again right there in, we find that in the Revelation 7 ceiling. We're also going to see it again in Revelation 12. There is a crying, travailing in the church right now. You're going through tribulation, persecution. Thank God for it, because you're called for this great work of God, because tribulation worketh patience, patience worketh experience, experience worketh hope. Somebody said, I'm not going through anything. Oh, friend, if you, all that live godly in Christ Jesus, shall suffer persecution. 2 Thessalonians, the first chapter, saith your faith groweth exceedingly, your charity of every one of you abound one to another. We're bound to thank God for you and all your persecution and tribulation that you endure. Why have that? Because it is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, that you might be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you also suffer. This great one in heaven, that woman, the church of the living God, clothed with the sun and moon and under her feet, upon her head a crown of 12 stars, she cried, being with child, cried, travailing in pain to be delivered. There's a birth coming forth of Christ in you. The little two witnesses that are the two olive trees, which is the two candlesticks, which is the church of the living God, that have the same face of Jesus, that is a lion, man, ox, and eagle, the four living creatures of Revelation 4, Revelation 5. They are the ones in Revelation 6 that one of the four beasts had come and see. There's the one preaching the everlasting gospel to all the world for a witness to all nations, then the end will come. Neighbor, I know that it's kind of just a brief summary here, but if you'd like to know more, we have an offer we're going to give to you. Be sure to take advantage of it. I know it'll be a blessing to you. Well, until the next time, this is Brother Dennis Spirit saying, behold the real Jesus.
Well, praise God, neighbor. We here at DBM want to give our thanks and gratitude for those of you who have given to the ministry to make this preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, not only in the United States, but also in the world. As you can see, we've had a great move in Africa with over 500 pastors coming in 2016 to this true Jesus. And you're the ones that made it available to them, made it possible for them to receive this word. You know, the Lord said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. That is the divine commission for all of us. Some of us can't go, and we realize that, but we will go in your stead. If you feel the Lord for a ministry that will verify and document your precious dollars that you send for the preaching of the gospel, as well as food and clothing for these underdeveloped nations, then give us a call. The number's on the screen, and I know that the Lord Jesus will bless you. Until the next time, this is Brother Dennis Spirit saying, behold the real Jesus.